details.
Thanks for watching News 12, On Your Side.
From the station that's on your side, News 12, first at 5, continues.
A low chance for severe storms this evening and rain moving through parts of our area.
Yeah, I want to show you a live look at our beach island camera. Whoa, it did zoom on Will there.
Just like the rain that we're seeing in our area.
Yeah, I also want to show you an intense clip of a Will. Want to go to a...
For today and the rest of the week, coming up in just about 10 minutes. All right, thanks, Riley. Nonprofits are doing everything they can to help those experiencing homelessness from ending up back on the streets.
Yeah, but emergency relief funds from the pandemic, they're wrapping up. Well, the problem, that still remains. Our Hallie Turner joins us live from our newsroom. And Hallie, you spoke with one man working to get back on his feet, but he's afraid one wrong move will send him right back to square one.
Yeah, Meredith, back in 2021, the United Way got millions of dollars in federal funding to help families in crisis make ends meet, anywhere from a light bill to rent. They've given out more than $11 million over the past 2 years, but the money's drying up. They've helped more than 2,500 families keep a roof over their heads and landlords keep cash in their pocket. But the program was never meant to last forever. Instead, it revealed a bigger issue and a bigger need as rental prices climb along with inflation.
60% of those families that we've helped more than once. So it shows that there's a bigger problem, and there's a bigger issue in our community than just what was initially meant for very temporary support when we found that over half of the families are getting help more than once.
With homelessness on the rise and the shelters like Garden City Rescue Mission at risk of closing without funding, those who are trying to get back on their feet are worried what happens without a safety net.
It would be just living on the street, from day to day. Panhandling, I guess, is the word that we use for that. And if you're not strong enough to go in the right direction and stay positive, if you don't have any foundation at all, you're just going to go down.
But United Way says even with the programs coming to a close, they have plans and other programs in place so that many won't need the assistance. And we'll have that update for you all new tonight on News 12 at 6 o'clock.
All right, thank you, Hallie, for keeping us updated on that important story there. As Richmond County continues to address the homelessness problems around the Washington Road and I-20 corridor, we're learning more about how they're helping repeat offenders. It's called Accountability Court, an alternative that, based on the crime, can help prevent the unhoused from going to jail because of their circumstances. Instead, it helps people get back on their feet and out of the court system. It's just ahead tonight, all new on News 12 at 6 o'clock. I'll take a closer look at how this program works and what's still up in the air.
Plane debris scattered across a pond in Sandersville after a plane crashed there today. Two people were hospitalized after authorities say a small plane crashed into a pond near Kaolin Road. It happened near the Kaolin Field Airport. Washington County Sheriff Joe Cochran spoke to us when the first call came in to 911.
Public Works crew was here doing some work. They heard a loud noise and then heard some people screaming. Sounded like they needed help, so they called 911. The deputies and emergency responders got on scene just a few minutes later, went into this wooded area and was able to find that an actual plane did crash and that there was people.
The sheriff says the pilot is 67-year-old Daniel Mesnard. The passenger is 69-year-old Timothy Fisher. Mesnard is from Florida. Fisher is from Ohio. We are still working on an update on their conditions.
Well, take a look at this. Lots of smiles from Washington County students today as they go back to school. Jenkins County also going back to school today. And as for some of our other counties, McDuffie students return to the classroom this Thursday, the 3rd. Screven County students return on August 14th, and Wilkes County on the 28th. Summer is finally coming to a close for a lot of these students.
It sure is. Tonight, across the country, communities will host get-togethers in honor of National Night Out. National Night Out is an event for the community and police to get together. It's held on the first Tuesday in August. Matt Peskin is the head of National Night Out and says it's important for the community and police to interact under positive circumstances.
It's not a burglary, it's not a traffic citation, it's not a medical emergency. Everyone is out,
to meet each other and have fun. And that's what builds relationships, and that's what builds safer neighborhoods.
In Aiken, there will be a National Night Out event and Back to School event tonight. It'll be at the Perry Memorial Park on Abbeville Avenue Northeast. There'll also be a kickball and a foam party. That all starts tonight at 6 o'clock.
The $4 billion film industry accounts for $3.5 billion in wages for more than 46,000 Georgians.
Reporter Abby Kasora is talking to some of those workers, trying to make sure they still have an industry to come back to when the strike ends.
When your clients are shut down, you're shut down.
From prop houses to production companies, Moonshine Mountain Post-Production puts the final touches on pictures and videos.
I want that to have a little glisten across the frame.
Owner Drew Sawyer says Georgia's film tax credit, implemented in 2008, changed the industry forever, attracting bigger productions for them to work on.
As we have the largest, most equipped, you know, filmmaking army in the United States.
No contract! No actors!
While the strike is taking away most of his work, he's channeling his energy into making sure that the tax credit never goes away. Making videos with graphic designers, colorists, composers, advocating for their industry and the money that it brings to our state.
This growing industry segment enables the state to keep the entertainment project long after productions finish shooting, capturing more and new revenue.
The film tax credit has grown 44% from 2016, but at a hearing last month, the state's economist suggested now may be the time to scale that back.
Now the Georgia film industry is a mature industry. Now I would think that the legislature would be sort of claiming victory.
Misty Holcomb with the Big Film and Entertainment Alliance says eliminating the tax credit would mean less work for people like Sawyer.
You have this whole economy, a creative economy of Georgians who have adapted their businesses or started businesses. Invested their own money.
The Georgia Tax Credit Review Panel will meet throughout the summer and into the fall, that they'll give their recommendations to the Georgia General Assembly. Now, they would need the majority of lawmakers to vote in favor if there were to be any changes. In Atlanta, I'm Abby Kasouris.
Well, breaking news live at 5, Augusta University announcing its Oak Hall campus residence renovation is taking longer than expected, and now around 400 students will need alternative housing.
Yeah, the university says it's providing this housing for students. All of this comes after months of issues at the campus following a broken pipe and water damage that it caused as a result.
And we'll continue to keep you updated as we learn more here.
Bringing a birthing center to Augusta. Just ahead, the push by one group to give mothers more choices. Riley?
And the rain's starting to get pretty heavy from our Beach Island camera. Here's a live look at it. Storms rolling through most of our central counties. We'll have an update on radar and those rain chances for the rest of the week, just after the break.
Coming up on News 12 at 6 o'clock, SCDNR caught an alligator in someone's backyard. We'll tell you what it took to catch it and what neighbors have to say about it.
So high temps Thursday and Friday should stay in the mid to upper 80s. Warm back up for the weekend, and Saturday, Sunday storm chances look to be mainly in the afternoon.
Breaking news out of Washington. A federal grand jury announcing former President Donald Trump is indicted in his 2020 election interference case.
This case is also looking into the former president's role in the January 6th Capitol riots. Trump's campaign team responding in the last 15 minutes, calling the indictment a witch hunt. His campaign questioned why it would take more than 2 years to reach this indictment, quote, right in the middle of President Trump's winning campaign for 2024. A grand jury is also considering an indictment into election interference in Georgia. A decision could come there in the next few weeks.
Bringing a higher level of care to pregnant mothers in Augusta. One woman is continuing to push for a birthing center here to give mothers another choice.
News 12's Taylor Martin breaks down why this is needed.
In an area with multiple health care providers to choose from, one woman says there's still not enough options for maternal health care in Augusta. It's why she's fighting to open an Augusta birth center, despite the obstacles the Georgia laws may bring. For Katie Chubb, providing women more options for maternal health care is a part of her American dream.
So I moved to the United States in 2009 with $100 to marry my husband. Part of the American dream is being able to reach any height.
After she wasn't able to obtain the required transfer agreement with a local hospital, outlined in the certificate of need law, she took matters into her own hands, testifying in front of Georgia lawmakers today.
I think we've changed a lot of minds today, and I felt the room shift and definitely wake up when we explained everything that happened to us.
Representative Mark Newton, who is a medical doctor, says the Augusta Birth Center is a good example of allowing people to choose their own health care.
But a birthing center could be a great additional choice for people. I look forward to seeing where we go next with trying to expedite that.
For Katie, it's a huge step forward in bringing more options and accessibility to Augusta's maternal health care.
In a post-Roe world, now more than ever, our services are needed, and we need to help women and give them options during childbirth.
Lawmakers are meeting in Albany next month to hear more public input on the Certificate of Need laws in Georgia. Reporting in Augusta, Taylor Martin, On Your Side.
All right, thanks for that, Taylor. Time is running out for Facebook users to claim a portion of a class action lawsuit settlement. Just ahead, we'll take a look at who qualifies and what you need to do to claim a share of the payment.
First Alert Radar, powered by Jim Hudson Lexus Acura Infinity.
I'm Chip Lewis with Augusta Medicare Specialist. Surprisingly, there is no Medicare orientation. Let us guide you through the entire process. For a commitment-free consultation, please give us a call or visit our website. Don't wait until you're 65 to call, or u64.com.
Shanty can
fix it. We can fix it.
Hey, Brett, I think we need a jingle.
What do you have in mind?
I don't know yet.
Well, if you're taking something, come knock on my door.
Come and knock on my door.
If you're 64.
Most everyone watching right now can join a lawsuit against Facebook over its privacy failures and claim part of a $725 million settlement.
Facebook is ordered to pay the amount because it didn't protect the private information of its billions of users. Our consumer tech reporter Jamie Tucker explains how to get your share.
This settlement is part of a $5 billion fine Facebook was forced to pay by the FTC for sharing personal information of its many users with the British consulting firm Cambridge Analytica. Now, back in 2018, many Facebook users shared a quiz called This Is Your Digital Life. Everyone taking that quiz shared their information with Cambridge Analytica. In fact, even if you didn't take the quiz, but your friends did, your information was shared too. The problem, Facebook didn't tell anyone. That's why Facebook's Mark Zuckerberg testified before Congress, and it's why Facebook is required to pay Facebook users $725 million. If you have or did have a Facebook account anytime after 2017, you're entitled to part of the settlement. You will need to submit a claim by going to the website FacebookUserPrivacySettlement.com. If you've deleted an account, just enter the approximate date you created your Facebook account and when you deleted it. How much can you expect to receive? That amount depends on the number of people who file claims. The more people who sign up, the less your amount will be. Now, once again, the deadline to file a claim for the Facebook privacy settlement is August 25th. If you don't want to join that lawsuit and settlement, you don't have to do anything. That's What the Tech. I'm Jamie Tucker.
And a judge will hear details about the settlement in early September.
Every year on the Sunday before the Masters, the Drive, Chip, and Putt National Finals are held at Augusta National.
News 12 Sports Director Dan Booth joins us live now with the latest on one of our local golfers who's one step closer to qualifying.
A couple of weeks ago, I had
here on the Sunday before the Masters, the Drive, Chip, and Putt National Finals are held at Augusta National.
News 12 Sports Director Dan Booth joins us live now with the latest on one of our local golfers who's one step closer to qualifying.
A couple of weeks ago, I had the chance to tell the story about Sadie and Addie Munns, a pair of 10-year-old twins from right here in Augusta who have been driving, chipping, and putting their way onto the scene. This weekend, Sadie Munns took first place at her sub-regional qualifier over in Savannah. This means Sadie is moving on to the regional qualifier at Sea Island with a chance to punch her ticket to the national finals at Augusta National next spring. Sadie's twin sister, Addie, is competing in a sub-regional qualifier in Columbia next month. You can find my full story story with the Munz twins on our website. When it comes to the pros, Tiger Woods announcing today he has joined the PGA Tour Policy Board for the first time in his 27 years on the tour. This is the first time players have outnumbered the independent directors on the board. The five-time Masters champ has the potential to give players a greater voice as the PGA Tour works on finalizing its deal with the PIF and LIV Golf. In a statement, Woods says, players will do their best to assure any changes in tour operations are in the best interest of everyone. That's it for sports. We'll be right back after this quick break. Cracks in your brick.